Passover took place on one night and at one meal, but the festival of the unleavened bread, which was celebrated with it, continued for one week. The people removed all yeast from their homes in commiseration with their ancestors' exodus from Egypt. When they did not have time to let the bread dough rise, thousands of people poured into Jerusalem from all over the Roman Empire for this festival and to celebrate one of the most important events in their history. God had rescued Israel from slavery in Egypt through great and terrible miracles. This great saving work laid the foundation for their understanding of God and their relationship to God.
That first Passover was a final climatic plague. a visit from the angel of death to kill every firstborn son in all of the land. To spare the Jews from the fate, God had instructed them to kill a lamb, a spotless, perfect lamb, and sprinkle its blood to the sides and to the tops of door frames around their homes. When the angel of death saw this evidence of faith, it passed over that house and traveled on to another. This event foreshadowed Jesus' death at the cross. As the apostle Lamb of God, his blood would be shed in order to save his people from the penalty of death by sin.
Jesus prays in Gethsemane. After eating the Passover with his disciples, giving to them the Lord's Supper, they left and went to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. Grief and anguish came over him, and he said to them, "The sorrow in my heart is so great that it almost crushes me. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went a little further on, threw himself face downward on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, take this cup of suffering from me. Yet I want your will, not mine." Then he returned to the three disciples and found them asleep. And he said to Peter, "How is it that you three were not able to keep watch with me for even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more Jesus went away and prayed, "My Father, if this cup of suffering cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done." He returned once more and found the disciples asleep. They could not keep their eyes open. Again Jesus left them, went away, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then he returned to the disciples and said, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be handed over to the power of sinful men. Get up and let us go. Look, here is a man who is betraying me." Jesus knew what lay ahead of him, and he knew the reason. Even so, his struggle was intense. His prayer reveals to us his terrible suffering. His agony was worse than death because of his approaching separation from God and death for the sins of the world.
Thank you.
the betrayer. Matthew 26:20-25. When it was evening, Jesus and the 12 disciples sat down to eat. During the meal, Jesus said, "I tell you, one of you will betray me." The disciples were very upset and began to ask him, one after the other, "Surely, Lord, you don't mean me." Jesus answered, "One who dips his bread in the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man will die, as the scriptures say he will. But how horrible for that man who will betray the Son of Man. It would have been better for the man if he had never been here." Judas the traitor spoke up. "Surely, teacher, you don't mean me," he asked. Jesus answered, "So you say." A hush fell over the room as Jesus spoke. It was customary for the master of the feast to put bits of lamb onto a piece of unleavened bread. It was customary to offer the first piece to the most honored guest. He handed the bread to Judas to take and to eat. How awkward that moment must have been in the eyes of the betrayer and the eyes of the betrayed man. "What are you about to do?" Jesus said. "Do quickly." It was the last summon. It was the last command of Jesus that Judas would obey. It would be the last intimate moment what he had spent with his Savior.
As we pause this night to
commemorate the suffering and anguish that your son felt as he went to the cross to save us and save our sins. We would just ask that as we partake of the Lord, that draws closer to you and the real meaning of what this season of the year means to us. That your son was crucified for our sins. Guide us, direct us, forgive us our many shortcomings. These things we ask in your son's name. Amen.
And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and he blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body."
Thank you. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Shall we pray? Lord, we thank you for this Easter season. We thank you for all the people that help to remind us of this. We thank you for the church here that observes it. Help us to gain a feeling of how precious this is to us. At the same time, remind us of how unworthy we are. And we are the sinners that he died for. And we do need this. And we do thank you for it. Be with us this night and be with us this season. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for the remission of sins. Drink ye all of it.
He is despised and rejected of men. As man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed.
And we are so thankful for that. I pray that you would be with us, and may we think about the communion that we have taken tonight. We realize that it is because of what you did, because of your body that was broken for each one of us, and the blood that was shed that we can have eternal life. And it's because on the third day that we can celebrate Easter. And what a glorious celebration that is. It's the highlight of the Christian life to celebrate Easter, because we know that we have new life in you. Pray that you would bless us now. Help us to think about what we have done tonight. And may we ever, ever be thankful for you, Lord. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.